and welcome to Into the Word, our daily dive into the depths of God's Word. I'm Pastor Malcolm. Our hope is that this time will help you glorify God, grow as equipped disciples of Jesus Christ, and go boldly proclaiming His gospel to all. Today is Wednesday, August 12, 2020, and our passage this week is from Titus chapter 2, verses 10 through 14. Let's dive in. The Reverend E.V. Hill was a pastor of Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church in Los Angeles for many, many decades. Where the church was located there in Los Angeles, there was a very large homeless population as well as a lot of gang activity that the church was regularly engaged in ministering to the needs of all of those that were in their community. I remember watching an interview with Dr. Hill many years ago. He was giving it to ABC or CBS, NBC, I can't remember which one. It was one of their nightly news magazines. And as he was walking the streets with the interviewer looked around and pointed out all of the homeless people that were there and all of the devastation just within the community, and turned to Dr. Hill to say, if the gospel is such good news, if the gospel is such a good thing for people, why so much devastation? Why is there no change, seemingly no change in this community? And Dr. Hill smiled and asked the reporter, when you take a shower, do you use soap? And the reporter looked a little perplexed at him and said, well, of course I do. And he says, if you want to get clean, you have to apply what has been given to you in order to get clean. And left it at that. And I found his point profound and very easy to understand. The gospel is available to all. And often what we forget about in that is that because it is available, in order for it to have its intended effect of bringing forgiveness of sin, of reconciling us to God, of growing us into the image of Christ, we actually have to apply what the gospel has done into our lives. We looked this past week, and as Micah was preaching, he said, grace is not opposed to effort. It is opposed to earning. And that is a critical area that we need to understand in our own lives, a critical truth that we need to, I think, in many ways, recapture as God's people and as disciples who are following after Christ. We're going to be looking today at Titus chapter 2, verse 12. And I'd encourage you to turn there in your Bibles as we come before the Lord in prayer. Father, again, we want to thank you for the day that you have given to us today. And I'm thankful, Father, that as we think about the gospel, as we think about growing in godliness and being godly people, that you have provided for us the very means, the very effect for that to happen. And I ask, Father, that you would help us to examine our own hearts, examine our own lives, to see where we are at in that. What it is that we ourselves may need to do in humbling ourselves before you, perhaps in coming before you and confessing before you our own sin and our own laziness in not using and not availing ourselves of the gospel effectively. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to pick up in verse 11, just reading that again to keep us in context as we look at verse 12. Paul says this, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people. We looked at this yesterday in the sense of Jesus literally coming, entering into human history, into time as God the Son, taking on human flesh and coming to bring the gospel, to bring about what needed to happen for this good news to be able to be applied to our lives. We talked about this in terms of being the doctrine of grace. But Paul goes on now in verse 12 to talk to us about the effect of grace. There is intended to be an effect in our lives. And verse 12 says this. He says that the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. Now, Paul talks about the effect of the gospel in two ways. He gives some negative examples as well as some positive examples. I want you to notice first the word that he uses here, training. This is a word that comes out of the Olympics and the games that would have been known in Paul's day throughout the Roman world. Now, we obviously, in this year of 2020, were to have the Summer Olympics in Tokyo this year that has been postponed to 2021. And while I do not watch a lot of the Olympics anymore, I do appreciate just the amount of work that goes in to become a world-class athlete. You know, I'm reminded of Michael Phelps, the swimmer, the most recent swimmer of the United States, who has won just about everything that could be won in Olympic swimming. And here is a man who was said that would train upwards of 10 to 12 hours a day, having to eat upwards of 15 to 18,000 calories just to keep his body able to do what it needed to do to train, and was trained, you know, from the moment that the Olympics were over in 1 year, was already back into training for the next 4 years for the Olympics to come again. That's somebody who recognizes the value of training, the value of effort being put in to get out what you want to be able to get out of being the best athlete, a most world-class athlete in our time. And I think it's important that Paul uses that word training. That is communicating that we as believers, once we have responded to the good news of the gospel, now we have effort that we are to put in becoming more like Christ. Now, clearly, that is work that the Holy Spirit does. And that is work that God is doing in us through the indwelling Holy Spirit. But too often what we have done is we have taken that to say, because God does that work, I need to do nothing. And we take a very passive role in terms of our own sanctification. And yet the scripture speaks to us of the passive and active role of sanctification in our lives. We are passive in that it is God's work to do, but we are active in responding to the work that he is doing. We are passive in that it is Jesus's teaching that he has given to us, but we are active in applying that into our lives. So there is this training aspect, and training is an ongoing work in our lives. We are never going to out-train ourselves in growing in godliness. But the two ways that Paul says that we are to train ourselves negatively in godliness is we are to train ourselves to renounce ungodliness, that is to set it aside and say, I am no longer doing that anymore. One of my favorite passages is 1 Peter chapter 4, where Peter is talking to the believers there, and he's saying, listen, you have lived for the ungodliness in your life. You've done that long enough. It's time to stop doing it. It's time to set that aside. It is now time to be living for Christ. And that's really what he's talking about here, is that we renounce ungodliness. We renounce those things of our lives before we came to know Christ, that we say, I want nothing to do with that anymore. That defined who I was as a non-believer. I do not want to be defined anymore by that. And unfortunately, again, sometimes what we try to do is we try to Christianize certain ungodly behaviors. And that just is not, the scriptures give us no room to be able to do that. We are to renounce ungodliness, turn our back on ungodliness, and have nothing more to do with it. The other thing that we are to do, the second negative way that we train ourselves in godliness, is by setting aside or turning away from worldly passions. And again, this too is something that I think is very, very hard for us to do. The world is constantly calling out to us. Sin is constantly calling out to us to say, come back. It's not as bad as you thought. You know, the water's fine. The water's boiling, but the water's fine. Come on back. And this too is something that we need to learn and be diligent. And again, it is a training exercise in our lives to turn ourselves on those worldly passions. Because the reality is, friends, many of them do look good. They are appealing. We know that they would satisfy longing and desire and want in our lives. The problem is that they satisfy that with sin. And they satisfy that by separating us further from walking with our Father. And they satisfy that in many ways by growing within us an idea of cheap grace, that I can do whatever I want. I just need to ask forgiveness for it later. And yet, when we treat God that way often, if you think about it, though, if your children were to do that, that would never be acceptable. That would never be something that we would say, well, yes, that's okay. You go ahead and continue to do what you want to do. And you just know that if you want to make it right with me, you just come and apologize later. We would never say that that is acceptable. And yet that is often when we go after worldly passions, how we treat God's grace and how we treat his goodness to us. And so Paul says, renounce those things, turn away from those things, have nothing to do with those things. We don't want to come back to sin. You know, as the writer of the Proverbs says, that's what a dog does. A dog goes back to its vomit. And a dog goes back to those things that it has been expelling from its body and eats them yet again. And we are not to do that as Christians. So now we come to the positive ways that we are to have the effect of grace seen in our lives. Paul says that we are to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives. Now, some take this, and Micah took this as well, and I think that there is a lot to say to this. We take this and read this to say that there are three different relationships that we are looking at godliness in our lives. We have our relationship with ourselves. And one of the ways that we bring godliness about in our lives is we live self-controlled. We recognize that others cannot control me, that others are not where I put my hope in first in terms of humanity, that I need to look at and say, if there is going to be control in my life, it starts with me. I am the one that at least at a base level controls Malcolm. Malcolm is responsible for Malcolm's decisions, choices, actions, whatever it is that we want to add there. And I am the one that needs to be seeking to control me. I have self-control of me. Then there are those other relationships that we have with other people, whether that be with other believers or other non-believers, doesn't really matter, but relationships that we have with other believers, and there we are to live upright. We are to have the effect of grace create in us an upright sense of living, a sense of living in which I care for another, but a sense of living in as well in which I want you to be able to look at my life and see godly characteristics as a significant part of my life. That also means living upright. I'm going to live humbly, which it really is to say I'm going to live in such a way that I don't put myself as the absolute standard. I would put myself as a standard, much as Paul does, to say if you are looking for an example to follow, follow me, as Paul says, but only as I also am following Christ. And Christian, we need to again recapture that. We need not be afraid to have people follow our lives, look at our lives as examples to follow of Christ when we ourselves are also following Christ. And I think that is the key aspect. Of too many times we say, well, I don't want to be an example to others. But the reason we're saying that is because if we were to look at how we were following Jesus, we would not want them to follow that. And we should be striving to be so walking in the feet of Jesus, so following after Jesus, that even with all of our failures, all of our difficulties, all of our continuing to struggle with sin, others would at least be able to look and say, I want to follow Jesus like that. I want to follow humbly, confessing my own sin. I want to follow boldly, going where Jesus would call me. I want to follow faithfully, continuing to come back to Jesus through all things. So that's the second way. We live upright lives by living well and living godly lives before other believers. And then Paul gives this third one, that we are just to live godly lives. And this, I think, is just that relationship between us and the Lord, that we are to live in such a way that is pleasing to the Lord. We are to live unto the Lord, as we would have said it, you know, in older language. We are to live in such a way that is going to bring him glory. That's why the first part of our mission as a church is to glorify God. We want to see, and we believe that we need to be working in all ways, at all times as Christians, to be glorifying God first in our lives. And so we have this totality of the way that grace affects our lives personally, relationally with others, and relationally with God. And it takes an overlaying of being committed to training in godliness, to saying, I am going to put into practice the very things that I read in the Word of God, that I know from the Word of God, that I hear in preaching and teaching and Bible studies, that are coming as a part of prayer, both personal prayer, corporate prayer, whatever it is, living out my faith in front of others, telling my faith to others. And the reason we do that, Paul ends this here, is that we are to do all of this in this present age. This is not something that we wait a while for, but it is something that we do now. So let me leave you with this question. How are you pursuing godliness in your life? What is it that you may need to, or that the Holy Spirit may be speaking to you right now and say, this is an area that you need to repent in. This is an area that you need to confess to the Lord, turn from in your life, and begin to walk in holiness, begin to walk in godliness, begin to live self-controlled in your own life, upright before others, as you have the effect of grace come to you. What do you need to wash? What needs to get clean? And are you going to take the very means and the tools God has given to you in that, his word, prayer, his church, and his people, in order to become more godly in your life today? Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you again for your word, and I do ask that for all of us, myself included, that you would bring to our minds areas where we are needing to confess sin, areas in which we are needing to respond to the convictions that you have been bringing to us, areas in which we are needing to take a step of faith and say, I am going to live my faith more boldly before others. I'm going to seek to live upright, not so that anybody is putting me on a pedestal, but Father, so that they would bring glory to you. Help us, strengthen us, give us courage, and Father, help us to cling to you ultimately as the only one who provides the real effect of grace in our lives. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.